good morning, everyone. Welcome to this session. And we will begin with Carlos Castro for entitled the Numerical Approximation of the Decay Rate for some dissipative systems.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. This is a collaboration work with Ammari, which is the University of Monastir. So let me state the problem in a simple case, which is in fact the motivation of this work. We consider the wave equation with a damping term, then with in a bounded interval in 1D. So we will consider homogeneous boundary condition and some initial time. So it is known that due to this term, the energy of this of the solution of this system decays. So we define the energy in this way. And it is known that the energy is well, it is very easy to see that the energy decays. In fact, under some assumption from A, the energy decays exponentially, it decays exponentially in time for all solutions. So, of course, depending on what is the initial data, the rate the rate of decay of this solution is going to be different. So we are interested in the optimal value of this rate. It means the value that makes that all solutions decay faster than this this constant. So this is the idea, to find a numerical approximation of this object. So maybe in a more graphical way, you consider the string with a damping, which is usually localized in one part of the domain. Then due to this damping, any solution is going to decay, and it's going to decay exponentially to zero. The energy is going to decay exponentially to zero. So, but each solution has a decay, and we are interested in knowing what is the value that assures us that all solutions are going to decay faster than that. So this is what it is known, the decay rate of this equation, and it's going to depend on the dissipation. So the idea is how to recover numerically such an object. So this system can be written in a more general setting, which is the setting that we consider. If we write u and u prime as y, then you can write this equation in a system, a first order system, where this capital A is this operator, which is skew-adjoint, and the dissipation comes from this operator B, which is now here. So here is the initial data, and we are. This is stated in a Hilbert space. In this case, it's just H1 times LP. So, in this general setting, you can ask the same question. A natural characterization of such a decay rate comes from the spectrum of the operator A plus B. So in fact, if you consider an eigenvalue of this operator, then if it is the associated eigenfunction, you can construct a solution that decays as the real part of this lambda. So as you consider all solutions of this type, when you consider all solutions of this type, you realize that the decay rate should be greater than the maximum or the supremum of all the real parts of all this eigenvalues of the operator. So this object, which is the supremum of all the real parts, is known as a spectral artisan. So so it is natural, well, it is obvious that this the decay rate should be greater or equal than that. But it is not so clear if it is going to be greater or equal. And this depends on the cases. Sometimes it is equal, as we will see, and sometimes it is going to be slightly greater. So we have here the situation. We were starting with the decay rate But we have reduced some, sorry, I'm going to tell you, we can reduce this problem sometimes to look at the spectral abscissa, which is the eigenvalue with the larger real part. So this is somehow, well, this is not completely easy because you don't know exactly what is the eigenvalue which is going to give you the spectral abscissa. So you have to consider all the eigenvalues to know what is going to give you this maximum real part. So, but here the situation is much worse because you have to consider all solutions of the system in order to see what is the one with the worst decay. So, well, sometimes, as I have told you, these two things, the spectral abscissa and the decay rate, are the same. So this is, for instance, the case of the one-dimensional wave equation, as long as the dissipation, the dissipative term, is has some regularity, just in dB. So in this case, you can prove that both things are the same, and the decay rate can be estimated using or looking at the spectral abscissa. So when this is true, well, this is true basically when the eigenfunctions are enough to represent all possible solutions of the system. So basically, this is true when the eigenfunctions of the operator constitute the basis of the Hilbert space. So when this is true, then you can characterize this decay rate with the spectral abscissa. If not, you cannot. So similar questions arise in another damped system, like a Schrödinger and beam, where you can prove similar results to this one. In Eiger dimension, things are much more involved because you can see that the spectral abscissa, even if it plays a role, it is not sufficient for giving you the decay rate. So in fact, there is another quantity which enters, which is the dissipation of a solution concentrated along rays. So the spectral abscissa is one of the things you have to see in order to see what is the decay rate, but you also have to, if you consider for instance a square and you have your dissipation in this part, then you have to consider any possible solution that should arrive to the zone where we put the dissipation, and you have to see how the solution concentrated in this ray dissipates energy. So in particular, if you have a situation where the dissipation is here, and you have, then you can construct the solution along characteristics, very concentrated along characteristics that never meet this zone where the dissipation acts, and you will not have exponential decay in this case. Even if you can have, as we will see, you can have an spectral abscissa lower than zero. So in higher dimensions, everything becomes much more difficult. So what we are going to do is just we are going to see a method to compute this spectral abscissa. So when this spectral abscissa is the same as the decay rate, then we find an approximation of this decay rate, but if not, we just approximate the spectral abscissa. So what are the difficulties in this problem? The main difficulty is that you don't know what is going to be the eigenvalue which is going to give you the spectral abscissa. So you need an approximation of the whole spectrum. If you want to be sure that you capture the value with the largest real part. And the other difficulty is that the underlying operator is not a skew-adjoint or subspaces, so techniques are not so standard. So these are the two main difficulties here. So this is a general setting where we state our result. This is a skew-adjoint operator perturbed by bounded operator, which makes this system dissipative, and we are going to prove some. We are going to give a method to provide the maximum real part of the mean values. So, what happens if you try what it is the most natural approach, which is finite element or finite difference? With finite difference is the same, but with finite element, this is the situation. So I have considered the wave equation with a damping concentrated in this interval. And when you look at the spectrum of the discrete approximation, when you replace the Laplacian by the finite difference or the finite element, or using the finite element method with the discrete approximation, then you realize that there are some high frequencies that has a real part that becomes zero, very close to zero. So you can think if this is coming from the problem or the numerical approximation. Then in order to see that, you consider thinner meshes, and then you realize that these eigenvalues that were having a real part near zero, now the real part are not so close to zero, but there are new high frequencies that have this behavior. And this real part is approaching, as we take the discretization parameter larger, we are approaching more and more to the zero, to the imaginary axis. So if you look at the spectral axis here, you see that the spectral axis is almost zero, but this is not the situation for this damping. So the convergence for a finite number of eigenvalues in this situation is known from the 70s. There are some results on that. Because in fact, if you look at the low frequencies are well approximated, more or less, at least when you make it thinner meshes, things become close, but it is in the high frequencies where you have the problem. So this was the approach that used Ash and Gillebeau in 1999 in order to approximate the decay rate numerically. So what they did, in fact, is a filtering method where you cut you compute this, but you only consider the spectral axis associated to the lower frequencies. So this has a problem, because you don't know where you have to cut here in order to be sure that you don't lose a possible spectral axis coming from any value in this region. So this is something that you can do numerically, but there is no proof that you really capture the real decay rate. So, well, this is a little bit the problem. What people have tried to do also is to introduce a numerical viscosity in the operator, in the discrete operator, in order to recover the exponential decay, because we lose the exponential decay for the discrete system. In order to recover this exponential decay, you can introduce a numerical viscosity in the operator. So this is a classical regularization method. That and then you can find that in several papers, you can find that you can recover this that the spectral axis is low. It is basically given by the first eigenvalues, and then you recover the exponential decay for the discrete solution. But the price that you what you pay when you do that is that this method, in fact, push all the frequencies to the left, so that those frequencies that were going to come here are now here. But well, it is make a so drastic change in the high frequencies that if you have you still have the approximation for low frequencies, but if you have the spectral axis in this region, this is going to be very hard that such a method captures of real spectral arcs. So this is what this is one of the things that people have tried. So what the method that we try and propose is the projection method. So what we do is just we project the invalid problem in the finite dimensional vector space generated by the first n eigenfunctions of the skew-adjoint operator. So we consider the unperturbed operator. We compute, if we know the eigenfunctions of this unperturbed operator, then we construct this finite dimensional space and we project our invalid problem on this space. Then we find a discrete eigenvalue problem, and which is given by this formula, and we try with this method. Well, turns out that this method works quite well. This is the same example as before, and you can see that this is the spectrum that we obtain with this method. So the spectral axis is given by this, and if you make a thinner discretization, you consider a larger space for the discretization here, then you obtain the same eigenvalue that you have here. You obtain, of course, more eigenvalues, but the spectral axis is still given by this one. So it works quite well in this example. And in fact, we realize that it works in a very large number of examples, even if they are very similar. For instance, we consider here a didac for the damping, and we see what happens with the spectral axis in this case. So this is the spectral axis when you have a constant damping, so this is -1, and when you approach the didac, you go to the left. Then you can see this is the spectral axis when you are approaching the didac. Of course, in the case you have the didac, then the spectral axis is zero. This is known because there are some solutions where this didac is not acting. So you can also see some similar phenomena like this non-smoothness of this parameter, which comes from the fact that the spectral axis here is given by the first eigenvalue, here part by the second, here by the third, and so on. So you have the spectral axis is not given by the same eigenvalue, and this provides you these non-smoothness points. So you can also see that there is not monotonicity. So there are some regions where there is not monotony. So this is something that happens in this case. So we tried another situation when we change the position of the damping. We move, instead, consider the damping which is constant in one small region, and we change the position of this damping term. And then what we compute the spectral axis, and we find this feature, when you can see that there are many local minima, and it is, again, it is not continuous. So it is continuous, but it is not smooth. So you can see that if you put, for instance, a classical problem is to find where to put the damping in order to have the highest decay rate. This is a hard problem, hard optimization problem, because the cost functional is really very crazy. We find the best location of the damping is not an easy task. So there is another situation where it works also quite well, which is when you consider an oscillating damping which approaches weakly to an average. So in the limit, this average provides you an uniform damping for which the decay rate is -1. But when you approach this in this way, this is a singular approximation of this constant value, then you realize that the spectral axis grows. So it is much worse when you consider this than when you consider the limit case. So in this situation, it also works well. So there are another singular situation, it is when you consider indefinite dampings. So instead of considering a positive damping, you include some negative, damping in some part of the domain. Then it is known that if this is not very large, then you still have exponential decay. So this is what happened in the left in the right part of this picture. This corresponds to a part where this is very small. This well is very small. When you increase the well, you increase the part where this is negative, then the decay rate becomes the spectral axis becomes larger, and in particular there is a moment where it touches zero. From this moment, even the zero solution becomes unstable. So there is here in this region you have an instability of solutions. So this is the case where just this is the spectrum where you just cross this point. So for Schrödinger equation and plate models, things are completely similar. So I'm going to skip that, but it is interesting to know what happens in the 2D-dimensional wave equation. Let's try again with a damping which approach a Dirac. So what we have now is again a Dirac, but a Dirac in the two-dimensional case, so we have a square, and we approach a Dirac in the middle. So this is a section of this approximation of the Dirac. Then what we have here is the behavior of the spectral aphysa. We see that when you are close to the Dirac, it is almost zero, but it is what you observe is when you are far from the Dirac, then the spectral aphysa becomes negative. So this is a situation where you don't have this geometric control condition. So you don't have this because you have some rays, and if you concentrate, use solution that concentrates energy in these rays, this is going not, this is not going to dissipate, to dissipate. But in this case, even if you don't have a decay rate and exponential decay of solutions, the spectral aphysa is negative. So this is one case where this happens. So these are the spectrum in these two-dimensional cases. This is the case where it is closer to the Dirac, which provides a very high damping for the first frequency. The others are not so damped. And this is our intermediate situations where you can see the what is the aspect of the obtaining values. So another example is given by what considered by us and Le Beau in 1999. They consider a square again, and they put the damping term in one half of the square. So the geometric control condition is not satisfied. You can construct solutions that lives for large time here and never touch this zone where the damping is acting, so you don't have in this case this exponential decay for the solutions. So this is the spectrum in this case, which is similar what they obtain by this filtering. But here you can see that the spectral aphysa is also very close to zero. So in this case, with the spectral aphysa, you can detect that you cannot have exponential decay in this case. So another situation is when you consider again in the two-dimensional case a damping in a square, a small square that you move along the domain. So in this case, you can compute what is the spectral aphysa also, and this provides you this this picture where you can see that for some locations the spectral aphysa is zero, but there are other locations where it is small. So none of these cases satisfy the geometrical control condition, but sometimes you have the spectral aphysa lower than zero, and sometimes not. So this is. So you can see also if you try to optimize where you have to put the damping in order to have a better decay rate, this is going to be a hard problem, a hard optimization problem, because the cost function is a little crazy in this case. So let me just state the result and a very brief sketch of the proof. So in order to state the result, we have to have in mind some notation, because otherwise it is a little messy. So we have the unperturbed operator, which is skew-adjoint, and this has these eigenvalues and eigenvectors. These eigenvalues are, as this is skew-adjoint, are in the imaginary axis, so they are the blue points. So you have A plus B, which are the eigenvalues that you want, well, it's the operator whose eigenvalues you want to approximate. And I'm going to call it uk, uk, uk. And then you have the eigenvalues of the projection method, which are the approximated eigenvalues. This is what you compute numerically. So what you want is to know, to find bounds on how far are these triangles from the stars. Okay, this is what we want. But we are going to use the eigenvalues of the unperturbed operator in order to do that. Okay, so this is the theorem. Assume that the following hypotheses hold. So I'm going to explain very briefly the hypothesis. The first one is that the unperturbed operator is a skew-adjoint, okay, with simple eigenvalues. So in the case of two-dimensional problems, it doesn't work. So this theorem is basically for one-dimensional problems, even if the method works fine in these higher-dimensional problems. So the second hypothesis is that eigenvalues of this unperturbed operator are very well separated. So there is a spectral gap between them. So again, this is not true for the wave equation in the square, for instance. So there is a condition on the size of the bounded perturbation should be smaller than the first eigenvalue. And the last hypothesis is that the eigenvectors of the A plus B should constitute the least basis of H, which is true for many one-dimensional problems, but not in higher dimensions in general. So this means that there is some constant that if you take any linear combination of these eigenvectors, then you can bound it by below and by above by the coefficients. This is what it means that you have a least basis. So under this hypothesis, then we can prove that close to any discrete eigenvalue, there is a continuous one, and close to any continuous one, there is a discrete one. This is the approximation that we obtain. And this, quantity is bounded by a constant multiplied by this term, which is epsilon of B. I'm going to explain now what is this term. Note that this is true not for all frequencies, but for all frequencies up to a number R. So we don't have a uniform approximation of all the frequencies, but all but a finite number. But if finite number is fixed, that's independent of n. This is the point, and you can estimate it a priori. This is the point. So what is this quantity that allows you to bound the distance between the discrete eigenvalues and the continuous one? Well, this quantity is this, is written here, and it basically is a measure of the non-diagonality of B. So if B is diagonal, then due to the fact that these eigenfunctions, these are the eigenfunctions of the unperturbed operator, the skew-adjoint, these are orthogonal, so this is zero. But as you have if B is non-diagonal, as it is the case, then this is not in general zero. So this measure how non-diagonal is this B, because you are looking at what happens when I minus G is larger than R. So it's like if in a matrix you look what is outside of a bundle. If you look at outside of the band, then it is, if this is a small, then this band gives you the number of eigenvalues that you have to remove in order to have the result. So this is basically the result. So this this epsilon, this quantity, is not that difficult to estimate a priori in simple cases. For instance, in the one-dimensional wave for Schrödinger equation is given by this, and you can estimate very easily using the A1 of the norm, the derivative of it. So in practice, we estimate all frequencies but the larger two R frequencies, which is, but this R doesn't depend on n, and you can compute it a priori. This is a situation where it happens. When you consider this damping, then you can see that the larger eigenvalues are not very well approximated. This is one discretization parameter, and you double here the discretization parameter. So these are not very well approximated, but the number of frequencies that are not well approximated is fixed, and it is and you can estimate where this phenomenon appears a priori. Okay, so this is basically the situation. Let me just sketch very briefly the proof. The idea is to adapt a proof of Hausdorff that was done for a finite number of eigenvalues to approach the Hull spectrum. So there are several steps. The first step is this, what it is more, I think it's technical, but we couldn't avoid that. With this step, you cannot consider, for instance, any dimensional cases. So these are basic estimates where you take a ball centered in one of the eigenvalues of the unperturbed operator, and then with a given radius, you need to be sure that in this ball there is only one eigenvalue of the a plus b and one eigenvalue of the projection. So this is only necessary for the large eigenvalues. So for low eigenvalues, you don't need this condition. So this is the first thing to prove that. The second one, the second step is that you write as the eigenvectors of the a plus b constitute this basis. You can write the eigenvector of the approximation as a linear combination of these eigenvectors of the limit operator, and then using some algebra, you can find something like this, which is interesting because it appears here a linear combination of these eigenvectors of the perturbed operator multiplied by the difference between the approximate eigenvalue and the real eigenvalue. And then you use the fact that you have a Ritz basis for UJ, and you find something like this, which allows you to bound these terms in terms of the right-hand side. So this right-hand side term is what rests to estimate. So the step three is just to estimate this right-hand side. So the idea now is that you don't know these eigenvectors, but you can replace this U by the eigenvectors of the unperturbed operator, using the fact that you develop these eigenvectors in this basis, and you look at the Fourier coefficient, and you make some estimates, and you realize that you can replace this un by dp in this term. Then what you have to do is just to estimate this part, this term. But this term is again, it's a measure of how non-diagonal is b, because if b is diagonal, as this is an eigenvector of the unperturbed operator lower than with a parameter lower than n. When you, if this is the identity, for instance, then this is zero, because you project on the higher frequencies something which is on the low frequencies. So this is zero. If B is diagonal, it's the same. But if B is not diagonal, then this should be estimated by something measure the non-diagonality of the operator B. So this is basically where this term appears when you try to estimate this this thing. So in the fourth step, what we do is just once we know that. So this provides us an estimate of, well, this gives us that close to a discrete decay value, there is one continuous one. In order to prove that close to any continuous eigen value, there is a discrete one, then we use this localization of in the first step. So if the close to this one, there is one of these, and in this ball, there is only one eigen value for the operator A plus B and the projection, then they should be close. But here things are a little bit more messy, and you have to do an argument, technical argument, in a finite number of eigen values. Well, basically, this is how it works. Well, the conclusion is that this projection method provides a uniform convergence of the spectra, but not all the spectras, only up to a finite number of the frequencies. This works for a very large class of bonded operators, which are bonded perturbation, for a very large class of operators that are bonded perturbation of the skew-adjoint operators. The theorem only covers a particular class of these cases, but there are numerical evidence that it can be used in a much larger class. And the main drawback is that you have to know the eigenfunctions of the unperturbed operator in order to use it, because you project on this basis, so you need to know the basis. So in higher dimensions, with general domains, this is not known. Only you can use this method when you know a basis of the unperturbed operator. So in a square or simple domains where this is can be computed specifically. So, well, this is basically what I would like to talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
Yes.
You somehow split this kind of problem into kind of an operator where you know the eigenbasis decomposition, and then you have kind of the perturbation. Mm-hmm. And you somehow said, if I understand correctly, that this unperturbed operator is skew symmetric. But is it really required, or is it just more like natural from your application?
It is more natural from application. The unperturbed operator is usually skew adjoint. So it is more. In the application, you usually have this structure.
But would it, for example, help if you somehow add some kind of small dissipation into your unperturbed operator, which is uniform, and then have some perturbation with a positive and negative region?
I'm not sure if I understand well. So you mean that you perturb the operator with something which is unbounded, or?
So you take the original problem, and then you somehow use the unperturbed problem and the wave equation plus the uniform damping, so you can still explicitly compute the spectrum for this operator, and then as the perturbation you then have a
okay. Then you can try. Yeah. In this case should be okay. It's basically the same. No? I think so.
an equation and you know that there is an exponential decay rate, are you able to construct a method which respects this decay or with the good rate? I mean?
Well, this method provides you the rate because it gives you provides you the spectral axis. If you approach in a uniform way all the spectrum up to the last electrons. So as long as you know this spectral axis is the decay rate, then you approach this decay rate. This is the
engineer. Okay. More questions? Okay, so thank you again.